It started when I was 10. The neighbor's cat hated me. She hissed and clawed at my ankles as I walked home from school. I was afraid to kick her away. The owner was my mom's best friend, and I feared punishment if either of them saw. But I hated that cat, and I knew I had to punish her. I decided I would crush a few of my mom's aspirin and put it in some of the leftovers my mom made me take to her every night. I didn't think it would kill her, but if I'm not honest with myself, I was glad she was gone. I wish it had stopped there, but sadly it didn't. What had started with the cat grew into a hatred for all animals, all living things even. I killed dogs, raccoons, rabbits, it didn't matter. I learned that it's much more satisfying when you kill with knives instead of poison. I delighted in the feeling of a knife delving deep into flesh. Felt strong, fearless. Things I'd never felt before when I was a mere child fearing punishment. When I was 16 or so, something changed. I was never popular in school, but people stopped talking to me. They whispered when they thought that I couldn't hear that I was a freak. They were right to be afraid. The animals were no longer enough for me. I needed something more, something bigger. So I decided I would kill my little sister, Julia. My parents decided to go out one warm June evening, leaving me in charge of her. She was only 5, but I envied her. She, who got all the attention. She, who at such a young age had more friends than I'd ever had. So when my parents left, I set her in front of the television and planned. Close to dinner time, I asked Julia if she wanted to go for a short walk. I brought a backpack, saying that we could have dinner in the small clearing about half a mile into the woodland that spilled out for miles, that began a minute's walk from the backyard. We weren't usually allowed in the woods, though it was where I usually trapped and killed animals, so she was excited. While she was getting dressed, I packed. I put a serrated knife, a thick tablecloth, rubber gloves, a roll of duct tape, of which I ripped a small strip, a change of clothes and shoes, and scissors. We set off down the narrow path through the trees. When we finally reached the clearing, I let her walk ahead of me. I grabbed the strip of duct tape I had ripped off when we were at the house, walked up close behind her and put it over her mouth. Holding her still with one hand, I put on the gloves. I pushed her to the ground, binding her ankles and wrists with the tape. I placed her on the tablecloth, putting her as close to the middle as I could with her squirming. Cutting her clothes was easier than I had thought. She had dressed in a thin tank top because of the warm weather. I took out the knife and pushed it into her stomach slowly, savoring the feeling as the serrated edge tore through her soft skin, ripping through her organs. Streams of blood gushing out as I pulled it out just as slowly, then delved it in again, faster, not stopping until her muffled cries and the rise and fall of her chest had ceased. I carried her body to the deep river nearby and dumped it carefully into the current. After I had walked back, I took off the gloves and pulled my clothes from the bag and stuffed the soiled tablecloth and the remains of my sister's shirt in. Changing quickly, I also put my now stained and dirty clothes in the pack. On my walk home, I decided I should dump the bag in a dumpster at least a street away. When I finally returned home, I cooked a quick dinner of canned beef stew for my parents and waited. They came home only an hour after I had. "Where's your sister?" my mother asked as she sat down at the table while my father hung up their coats. I told her she had gone for a walk and I wasn't sure when she would be back. She looked at me wide-eyed. "You let your sister go for a walk by herself?" "Well, yeah. She's pretty smart. I'm sure she'll be fine," I replied, trying to stay calm. "She's 5. I can't believe you would be that irresponsible," she said. "How long has she been gone?" I looked at the clock, repressing my anger. I had done this for them. Could they not see how much of a burden she was? I guess half an hour? I haven't really been watching the time. Mom stood up and grabbed my father's arm with tears in her eyes. "Honey, go call the police. She's been gone for too long. What if something happened to her?" Father took out his cell phone and dialed 911. Walking to Julia's room and sitting on her bed. He came out a few minutes later and said they were looking for her. They believed me, I thought. We spent the next half hour waiting silently around the kitchen table when a knock came at our front door. Father jumped up to open it. "Yes, did you find her?" he asked hopefully. "I'm sorry, sir, but we found your daughter's body in a stream in the woods behind your house," the policeman replied. Mother broke down sobbing. Father knelt, attempting to console her. I did my best to look sad and a little confused, as if I couldn't believe it was happening. The policeman informed them that they would investigate, but I doubt I'll be caught. Nobody would think that even I, the freak, the lonely outcast, would kill his own sister. And that's not even the good part. I found out Mom's gonna have a child, and I can't wait to be a big brother again.